Here is another way to categorize solutions. We can refer to solutions as being electrolytes or non-electrolytes. A solution that is considered an electrolyte is a solution that conducts electricity. A solution that is a non-electrolyte does not conduct electricity. What makes a solution able to conduct electricity is the presence of ions in the solution. So the presence of ions means that you'll have an electrolyte solution. And this is exactly what happens when an ionic compound dissolves in water. Let's take an ionic compound, for example, sodium chloride. If I take solid sodium chloride and put it in water, what happens is it dissociates. It breaks apart into the ions that make it up. It breaks apart into the sodium aqueous ion, the AQ means aqueous, and the chloride aqueous ion. Now, besides the fact that it dissolves, which we talked about previously, that means it's soluble, it does dissolve, it then dissociates. When we say something dissociates, it breaks apart. So it literally breaks apart into the ions, and then my water molecules surround each of the individual ions, and that's attraction is something we'll look at later on in the semester. And so we say that the ions have been solvated, or they've been hydrated, because they are separately being surrounded by water molecules in the solution. The presence of these ions allows the solution to conduct electricity. This is why you don't want to put accidentally drop your blow dryer in your bathtub or in the sink full of water when you're in the bathroom, because you can electrocute yourself. Now, pure water itself is a non-electrolyte. Pure water, H2O, doesn't conduct electricity because there aren't any ions to break apart into. So a sample of pure water, if you accidentally dropped your blow dryer in it, nothing would happen, but don't try this at home. But your tap water has lots and lots of substances dissolved in it, and that's why it does conduct electricity. Let's look at this idea of dissociating a little bit more detail. Let's give a couple more examples. Because this is something that's going to help you practice your nomenclature, your ionic nomenclature. This all ties together. For example, if I have the compound magnesium nitrate, this is what magnesium nitrate's formula is. Magnesium is plus 2, the nitrate is a polyatomic ion, it's minus 1. That's why I have the 2 down here as a subscript on the nitrate ion. If I take solid magnesium nitrate and dissolve it in water, it will then dissociate into the ions that make it up. The magnesium ion makes it up, and the nitrate ion. Notice that I did not break apart the nitrogens and oxygens, because the polyatomic ion is the nitrate ion, the NO3 with a negative 1. In order to balance this, this is like a chemical reaction that needs to be balanced, I need a 2 in front of the nitrate ions. So this is a chemical equation representing the dissociation of magnesium nitrate. There's a stoichiometry involved. Every 1 magnesium nitrate gives me 1 magnesium ion and 2 nitrate ions. Now, if a covalent compound, not an ionic compound, but a covalent compound dissolves in water, and there are plenty of these that do this. For example, sugar, C6H12O6. If this molecule dissolves in water, and we all know sugar does dissolve in water, it does not dissociate. It does dissolve, but it does not dissociate, because there aren't any ions that make it up. Now, I could write a reaction or a chemical equation representing that. I could take the solid. What the product would just be the aqueous C6H12O6 molecule. And you'll notice there aren't any ions. That means it doesn't conduct electricity.